Morning, and a very lukewarm welcome to you all this morning. It's great to have you join us here, and also to those who will be watching later on, wherever you have gathered. It's great to have you join us here this morning as we worship God. The heating is just about finished, so hopefully in the next couple of weeks we'll have this place nice and toasty again. But you're doing well. And thank you to Alan, who has been doing all the work to fix and repair the boilers, and we do appreciate that. So this morning we are gathered here, for this is the Lord's house, and it's the Lord who welcomes you. The earth is the Lord and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. So we here in Uddingston belongs to God and all its people. Whether we know it or not, God is present. For we are made in God's image and we gather in God's name. Let's begin our worship now by singing our opening hymn, hymn number 485, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. let us speak with God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and holy God, we gather as your people to worship you, to praise you for being here among us, and to thank you that for all your goodness and greatness, you welcome us into your presence. We come in all our weakness and with all our failings, rejoicing that in Christ we have been cleansed and made new, and through him you have set your mark upon us and called us to be your people. Receive what we are and direct what we shall be. Loving God, forgive us when we fail you, when our lives betraying our calling and your love. Forgive us when people look at us and instead of seeing something of you, see only ourselves. Forgive us when the things we say and do obscure and deny the gospel, rather than proclaim its message to all. Help us truly to be a holy people, reflecting your love, showing your compassion, and responding to your guidance. Renew and restore us through the love of Christ and the inspiration of your Holy Spirit. Touch our hearts through this time together and strengthen our faith so that in the week ahead we may live and work for you to the glory of your holy name. So, loving God, receive what we are and direct what we shall be through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Any news anyone wants to share with everyone? Anything? Helen? Yes. A new grandson. Edward Stanley, to be called Teddy, which is lovely. And Mum's doing well. And Grammy's down visiting. So please pass on a congratulations to them all. Which is great news. And she has photographs. So if you want to see them at the end, he is just absolutely gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous. Any other news? Gillian? Oh, right. Hope, Jillian's daughter Hope, was at Victoria Falls and took a picture of David Livingston, but didn't realise the connection. Yeah, the connection, but yeah. The young people these days are. Yeah. I know, I don't think I've ever been in that place, and it's just across, like, what, 5-minute drive? We'll do a coffee there. So it is. Any other news? Yes, John? It's what? Your wedding anniversary. How many years is that now? 46. Lynette, well done. 46 years. Congratulations for that one. Well done, well done. Any other news? You've survived. That's the main thing. Yes, Rubina. The Stone of Destiny, did you pinch it? Was it too heavy? You tried then, you literally tried. That's a look nice in your garden.
Yes, indeed. And it sounds as if it would be boring that we all know the Stone of Destiny, but it's
good? Right. Oh, fantastic. The Stone of Destiny. I've seen the movie. I've got the book in the house. With many others, which I haven't read. But anyway, I will do when I retire. So I will. So, yeah. Any other news? Just any news upstairs? Just the three of you this morning? Oh, it's warmer up there, isn't it? Kind of. Anyway, I want to ask a question this morning. Put your hands up. You can put your hands up if you want, actually. I'm forgetting I was speaking to adults, not children. Do apologise for that. If you've ever been put on hold on a telephone. Yep. Eternally. Yeah. How frustrating is that? It's the music they play, isn't it? Ah, you think, change that piece of music. I think I must have walked down the aisle to, is it Packer Bells? Is that what you call it? Oh, for about half an hour. Yep, that one, yep. And you think, oh, you get a response and then it says, no, you're held in a queue. Yeah. It's quite frustrating, isn't it? I wonder how many of you have actually hung up and just thought, I'll give up. There's no point. I'll try again later. Yeah. And then my question would be then, did you try later? Or did you forget? You've probably forgotten quite a lot, isn't it? You think, oh, I can't be doing with this. It's even when you phone the doctors, isn't it? You're like in queue number 56. And by the time you get to number one, it says there's no place. You should have phoned at 8 o'clock this morning. You think, I've been on the phone since 8. But yeah, I was wondering, but it is about persevering, isn't it, when you've been put on hold, because you know you need to sort this situation out that you're dealing with, or you need an answer to the question that you want to ask. And the reason I'm asking this morning is I was reminded, I had a conversation with my son, which is very rare these days because he's never in, but anyway, this week, and he'd asked the question. The parish this week has been pretty tough. Lots of highs and lows, and it's been a bit of a challenge this week. And he was the one that said to me, "Have you prayed?" And I thought, "Oh, you've well seen, you're like 5 feet away from me because I couldn't quite reach you." And he said, "Because he said, you always tell me never to give up." And I thought, why do children always turn back the answers to you, don't they? You think, get. But anyway, and I says, I do pray and I do try. And he says, well, you're not trying hard enough. As you do. And he says, and you can't keep saying that God's disconnected you. Right? Because I used to say that, oh, God's not listening to my prayers. He's disconnected me because he's fed up listening to me. But it reminded me of that kind of phone call that you have to just keep bearing with it. And keep going, whether it's hard, whether you think your answers are maybe your questions or whatever the situation you're dealing with has not been answered, that you don't give up. And that's the joy about prayer. Sometimes we think, oh God, you are not listening to me. And you could be praying the same thing time and time and time again. And then all of a sudden you think, oh, that's been resolved. When did that happen? What happened there? And you don't sometimes notice. And that's the thing about prayer, isn't it? It's that we can all do it, but it's something that we have to work at, because it'd be so easy just to give up and think, God's not listening to me, I'm not going to try. Or it's God's fault, or it's God. Well, I keep saying he, but we know that God has no gender and various things like that. So if I do offend you by saying God is he, then just ignore me. Which she's a good at anyway, so that's fine. But that's the thing about prayer, that we don't give up. We just have to keep going amongst everything that life has thrown at us, and we just have to just trust in the Lord. And that's the thing about the Lord's Prayer. It's like when, and I'll be speaking about this later on, it's like the prayers, it's not just for me, it's for everybody. It says our Father. It doesn't say my Father, it doesn't say your Father, it doesn't say your Father, it's ours. And that's the thing. And when we come together as a church, as a community, to pray for each other, what a difference it makes. What a huge difference it makes. But all of us can do this. All of us can pray for ourselves, pray for our world, pray for each other. But the key thing is never give up. It might feel as if you've been disconnected. It might feel as if you've been put on hold. But persevere with it, because that's what we need. We need to persevere with prayer to get through whatever life brings us. So I want to just leave that with you this morning, just now. And we're hoping, all fingers crossed, let's pray for this one. Right, we're going to try this video, the Lord's Prayer, which we sang last week. We'll remain seated for this. And as I said, the Lord's Prayer is by Matt Mayer. Let's see if this works, David.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come.
Reading this morning, again, is taken from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 6, beginning at verse 5, but this time we're going to be using the Message translation. So let's listen to the Word of God. Jesus said, "When you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production either. All these people making a regular show out of their prayers, hoping for 15 minutes of fame. Do you think God sits in a box seat? Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense His grace. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are prayer ignorant. They're full of formulas and programs and advice peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. This is your Father you are dealing with, and he knows better than you what you need. With a God like this loving you, you can pray very simply like this. Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world right. Do what's best as above, so below. Keep us alive with 3 square meals. Keep us forgiving with you and forgiving others. Keep us safe from ourselves and the devil. You're in charge. You can do anything you want. You're ablaze in beauty. Yes, yes, yes. And then let us pray. Loving God, there are so many things to be thankful for. For life itself, recognizing that every life is worth celebrating. We take joy in the knowledge of God's immense creative love, which holds all things in being. Of God's immense patience, that means God's loving kindness endures forever. No matter what we say or do, believe or think, goodness and mercy will follow us all the days of our life. As we come just as we are, carrying the highs and lows of our own lives, there are times when we're exhausted, portraying a face for the outside world. You see what is beginning behind the mask that many of us wear. Our fears, our sorrows, our tears, our anger, our frustration, our exhaustion. So we come this morning just as we are. For some of us, we come as carers, often feeling overwhelmed and exhausted. And so we pray for moments of respite, to rejuvenate our spirit and restore our strength. Send help and support our way, whether through friends, family, or professionals, so that we can take the necessary breaks to care for ourselves. Grant all of us the insight to recognize when we need rest and the courage to seek it without guilt. For some of us, we come seeking healing for family and friends. May the power of the Holy Spirit bring forth healing and restoration in their bodies. May your divine touch be upon them, bringing comfort, strength, and healing to every area of their lives. We pray that you will grant them the peace that surpasses all understanding, guarding their hearts and minds. May your loving presence surround them, removing any fear, anxiety, or doubt. Let them feel your powerful embrace, knowing that you are with them every step of the way. We pray for wisdom and guidance for the medical professionals attending to their needs. Grant them insight and discernment in determining the best course of treatment and care. Give them the knowledge and skills necessary to bring about healing and recovery. But Lord, we also lift up their families and friends who are standing by their side. Comfort them in their moments of worry and uncertainty. Fill them with hope and strength, knowing that you are working all things together for their good. And may this time of difficulty draw them closer to you, deepening their faith and trust in your unfailing love. And use this season of healing to bring about a greater revelation of your power and goodness. For some of us, we come seeking solace as we mourn the loss of loved ones. In this moment, we lift our voice in remembrance of those we love, remembering that their presence in our lives were a gift and their memory forever etched within our being. Help us to cherish the moments we shared, the laughter and the love. May their spirit find eternal peace in your loving embrace. As we traverse this path of sorrow, wrap your comforting arms around each one of us. Let your grace be our guiding light, leading us to find solace in the midst of this profound loss. And though our heart aches, we trust in your plan and seek refuge in your boundless love. In the wake of our loss, there are times when we feel the winds of grief deep within our being. So mend our broken hearts and bring healing to our spirit. And when grief casts its darkest shadow upon our souls, be the beacon of hope that guides each one of us forward. Help all of us find glimpses of hope in the midst of despair, knowing that life is but a temporary journey and that reunion with our departed loved ones awaits in your eternal embrace. For all of us, we come just as we are, Lord, recognizing that all of us in our times face challenges that seem insurmountable. So help us to place our trust in you, knowing that you have the power to guide us through the toughest of times. Grant us the hope to see possibilities where others see obstacles, the faith to persevere in the midst of adversity. And with your love as our shield, we are ready to confront any challenge with resilience and determination. And so we thank you for being our rock and our fortress as we offer up these prayers and our prayers spoken and unspoken. So, loving God, hear our prayers. Amen. Let us sing hymn number 482 from Mission Praise, Nearer My God to Thee. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, for you are our strength and our redeemer. Amen. As I said earlier, prayer is one of life's great mysteries. Most people pray at least sometimes. Some people in many different religious traditions pray a great deal. At its lowest, prayer is shouting into a void on the off chance there may be someone out there listening. At its highest, prayer merges into love. As the presence of God becomes so real that we pass beyond words and into a sense of God's reality, generosity, delight, and grace. But for most Christians, most of the time it takes place somewhere between these two extremes. To be frank, for many, prayer is not just a mystery, but a puzzle. They know they ought to do it, but they aren't quite sure how. And so we ask the question, Lord, teach us to pray, and we are guided by Christ's teaching when he tells us how when delivering the Lord's Prayer. But the first thing to remember is that the Lord's Prayer is a deeply meaningful prayer. It isn't a magic formula, an abracadabra which plugs into some secret charm or spell. It is something we can mean with our minds as well as we say with our lips. It implies strongly that we humans can and should use our ordinary language in talking to the Creator of the universe, and that God wants and intends us to do so. It implies, in other words, that we share with the one true God a world of meaning which he wants us to explore. And there's a story which was set in a quiet Umbrian town many years ago, where a wealthy lawyer heard reports of a 25-year-old ex-soldier called Giovanni, who had recently given everything he owned to the poor. Everyone in the town had their own opinion about this man. Was he crazy? Was he out of his mind? However, determined to find out for himself, Bernard of Quinterval invited Giovanni to stay the night and stationed himself to spy on his guest through a secret peephole. As the house fell silent, he watched in amazement as Giovanni sprang from his bed, knelt down and began to repeat a single, simple phrase again and again. My God and my all. My God and my all. And tears ran down his cheeks as he said, my God and my all. Bernard of Quinterval was so inspired by Giovanni's self-evident, all-consuming love for the Lord that he followed his example. He gave away his wealth and became the young man's first disciple. Within a year, there were 11 of them. Within a decade, there were more than 5,000. And within 20 years, the course of European history had been realigned by the joyous life and simple teaching of Francis of Assisi, as Giovanni is better known today as. And what's interesting is that the Marxist leader Lenin once said, give me 10 men like Francis of Assisi and I will rule the world. Which is ironic because Francis and his followers never wanted to rule the world, having relinquished money, power and worldly prestige. Theirs was a revolution founded on prayer, not in domination, but on adoration. And the compelling simplicity of a fully surrendered life that cries out night and day, my God and my all. As Francis of Assisi wrote, all who adore him must adore him in the spirit of truth. And day and night let us direct praises and prayers to him, saying, our Father who art in heaven. So the second thing is, what do we mean when we pray the opening line, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name? And the reason I ask this is the way we view God will affect everything about our prayer life and the primary purpose of our own lives, as it will have an impact on how we view this prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. So what does it mean to call God Father? For Jews in Jewish days, Jesus' days, this title for God went back to God's action in the Exodus, rescuing Israel from Egypt and so demonstrating that Israel is God's son, God's firstborn. The idea of God as the Father comes when Moses marches boldly to stand before Pharaoh and says, "Thus says Yahweh, Israel is my son, my firstborn. Let my people go so that they may serve me." For Israel to call God Father was to hold on to the hope of liberty. The slaves were called to be sons. Now Jesus in his own time probably originally taught this prayer in Aramaic, the primary spoken language of the Jewish people of Jesus' time. And when Matthew and Luke wrote their biographies of Jesus, they translated the Lord's Prayer into Greek, which was a written language. And if Jesus originally gave this prayer in Aramaic, then the word for Father Jesus would have used would have been the Aramaic term Abba, and I don't mean the band. The term Abba was a familiar term of endearment that a child would use to address his father in the context of family. But here's the thing. A first century Jewish person would never dream of approaching God in this way. To call God Abba would have seemed too irreverent and familiar. Yet this is the way Jesus invites us to approach God. Jesus teaches that God's name is to be revered and kept holy, which means it should be honoured and respected in our own lives and our own actions. And the Greek word for holy is hagizou, meaning to sanctify, set apart or make holy. This indicates a profound respect and honour for God's name. And so we as Christians are called to honour God's name by living in a way that reflects God's character. Our words, our actions and decisions should all point to his holiness. By understanding God as our Father in heaven, we should transform our lives through how we live and pray. And so we should let us embrace the intimacy of calling him Father. Revere his majesty as he sits enthroned in heaven and honour his holy name in all we do. So the Lord's Prayer is the invitation which Jesus gives us when he teaches us to pray. Not to just say prayers, but to enter into a deepening, rich life of authentic communication with God. The first Christians understood the sovereignty of God in a way that we don't or can't or even won't. They knew how to kneel. They understood the fear of the Lord, the reverence he deserves, and even the dreadful thing. It comes sometimes, as the writer of Hebrews says, to fall into the hands of the living God. And if truth be told, we could probably at one time or another fall into the living hands of God because of what life is throwing at us. Let's be honest, sometimes life hurts, and deleting God from the equations doesn't actually help. It merely removes all meaning and morality from the mess and all the real hope for the future. So when life hurts, instead of turning away, let's fall into his living hands and be with God as we call him our Father. And the third thing to notice about the prayer, it doesn't state my Father in heaven, but as I said earlier, our Father. We are reminded that we pray this prayer as part of a community, not simply the human race, but as part of the Christian community, who have come together to know God as our Father through Jesus Christ, God's Son. And whether we pray this prayer alone or with others, We pray this prayer as part of a community, reminding us that we are not alone. We are part of something much bigger than ourselves. So here we have in the opening line of the Lord's Prayer, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name," which is an invitation to participate in honouring God's name. And when we pray this prayer, we are affirming our place in Jesus' church, that we are distinctively Christian, and that we can only love, serve, and God and obey God as part of the Christian community. So we are stuck with God, even when we don't understand God, even when we don't completely like God. It often turns out that God is all we have got at that time. And surely that is enough for all of us. As Augustine in his commentary of Psalm 148 writes, "God's ear hears the heart's voice, for it is the heart that prays. It is to the voice of the heart that God listens, and it is the heart that he answers." So for the next few moments, let's fall into the living hands of God as we bring our own prayers from our hearts to God, as we listen to Andre Bocelli sing the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Amen. Let us continue our worship by making our offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, all we have comes from you. Our world so full of beauty, our lives so rich in blessings, our faith so laden with joy. Receive now these gifts we bring to you, and teach us to use all you have given to us responsibly, generously, prayerfully, and lovingly, to the glory of your name. Amen. Just a couple of intimations, just to say there'll be tea and coffee after the service and everyone's welcome. The walking group will meet tomorrow at 10:30 in the car park if anyone wants to join them. Again, it'll be weather dependent. The community cafe is back on this Friday, and again, everyone's welcome to come along at 12 o'clock, isn't it, Liz? Yep, as well. So before we bring our service to a close, can I thank you for joining us here this morning for worship, and also to those who will watch later on our online service. Again, it's good to have you join us. I do hope that you have a blessed week. And we're going to bring our service to a close now by singing a closing hymn, hymn number 622. We sing A Love That Sets All People Free.
Thank you.
blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you, those whom you love and those whom you struggle to love, now and forevermore.